Now, at the age of 19 in 1946, Gene Winfield jumped headlong into this new hobby, personalization and customization of cars. And he did it all in his mum's backyard. Well, to be precise, it was in his mum's chicken coop, or shed, if you like.
After a tour of service in the US Army, where he ended up running a hobby shop in Japan, he returned to the States and dove headlong back into hot rodding. He was already a dab hand with a wrench and his customising business was booming. I could keep going on, but I'm just about at his shop.
The guy's been on the planet for over 90 years, so the guy's brain must be just full of car knowledge and car passion, and I can't wait to tap into it. You never get a day older, Gene. I think you've been like this since the 1950s. I think you just stopped in the 1950s.
Good to see you.
And you, great to see you, thank you. Well, thank you for allowing me to come out here today. I was just admiring your boneyard.
Oh, yeah.
It's fantastic. Should we have a little stroll?
Yes, let's take
a
look.
It's great, yeah. I mean, half of this stuff, Gene, that's here, I mean, for you, as a fabricator, you can just come out and pick what you like.
Yes, a lot of these cars are here just for me to do that. I just took the roof off of a Jag, an old Jaguar back here, and put it on a Chevy.
Oh, that's sacrilegious. I don't know what my queen would say about that. My queen might say a few words about, off with his head, she might say. It's a sad fact that every car's final stop is a boneyard. But I like to think that a car would prefer to end up here as raw material for Gene rather than crushed into a metal cube.
I know that you're quite a modest man and you won't like me saying this, but you are a living legend. Everyone knows you in the hot rod community. Everyone knows you in the fabrication world.
Yes.
When did it very first start for you? When was the first time you see something like this and you said, I can change that, I can make it better?
Well, back in the 50s. You know, I started doing cars in the 50s, and I would look at a car and decide, I can change this and change that and make it look better. And we like to say we go for the wow factor.
Yeah, yeah. Gene, the 1950s is 70 years ago.
Yes.
70 years ago.
Yes.
So that's a long time ago, isn't it?
Yeah. And I've been doing this for 77 years.
I can't get my head around it. I can't get my head around it. 77 years of car fabrication, and you've still got a customer order book that's full today.
Oh, yes. I still love it, and I love to paint. You know, I developed the blending of paint. Yep. And I'm still doing that quite often.
Can we go and see the shop? Is that possible?
Yeah, sure.
Now I've made you walk all the way down here. Should we walk all the way back?
No, it's all right. I got guys working and I got to go to work anyway.
All right, okay. Well, let's come and join in with the day.
Okay.
So we're going in this shop here, are we? Yeah, this is more like it. Look at that. Now you can feel that you're in the heart of Gene's mind.
Yes.
That's crazy, Gene. Look at this thing.
This is a 54 going to Japan. And I extended the rear fenders and putting 60 Chrysler taillights and then built this all on the trunk lid.
Wow.
Just to be different.
The chop on that roof, Gene, is just insane. Look at that. I mean, the way that it's angled in, that's...
Yes.
That's crazy work, isn't it?
And I slanted the post. Used to be straight up and
that
down.
That used to be a straight post. You've slanted it.
Yes.
Not one part of this you can go and buy off a shelf. It's not as if you can walk into a dealer and say, give me the extended fender for this Ford.
First, we'll make a cardboard template, just kind of look at it and get it approximately what we want. Then we go from the cardboard to metal, make a metal piece and keep adjusting it, moving it around until it flows. It has to flow just right.
This is the Ting, isn't it?
Yes.
This is the vehicle that you drove 135 miles an hour in.
Yes, I later went 139. That's my 27 Model T, which used to be very tall. It was straight up and down. I chopped it 12 inches and laid the windshield back, you know, for streamlining.
Gene ran this car at the Bonneville Salt Flats in 1951. For reference, the top speed of a stock 27 Model T is 45 miles an hour. Gene tripled that.
This has a big flathead motor. See, the stock cubic inch of a flathead is 239 cubic inch.
Right.
This one is 325 cubic inch.
Right, so it's a big motor.
It has a special crank, a billet crank, that's 5/8 of an inch longer stroke. Then also, I have four exhausts, one exhaust coming out of the top. So it's the only flathead around that has four exhausts.
That's amazing. Not only were you putting all this stuff together,
You were the one behind the steering wheel. You were the one testing your own right. hypothesis. Would this work? I think it'll work. Let's try it.
Yeah, that's right.
Exciting days. And this, Gene, is that famous blended paintwork that you've done on the car.
I painted this car, and it had big windows in here with lime-colored plastic, and they were leaking water and got in a rusted part of the roof. So I cut the old roof out, and this is a car. This has a Jaguar roof right here. From here to here is all Jaguar. It happened to fit the contour just right. And so, but this is one of my blended paint jobs. So I start with different shades of lime and then blend into green and bring it back up. So always darker on the bottom, lighter on top.
And that was your signature back in the day, wasn't it?
It still is.
It still is.
And then on the hood, it has my skunk stripe. Let me close the hood for you.
All right, sit down the middle.
You call this a bonnet.
We do call this a bonnet. Don't ask me why, but we call it a bonnet.
But see, I have the white pearl blending off very carefully in through here.
Do you see a car and think, immediately, once you see it, I know what I want to do with it?
Yes, I'll study it for 10 or 15 minutes, maybe, and I decide that I can change the taillights and I can change the grill, and then this is how I'm going to paint it. So, yes, I figure that out just very quickly because I've done it over and over.
I think you built cars for, Man From U.N.C.L.E.?
Yes, Man From U.N.C.L.E., Get Smart, TV, and then for movies, I did the original Blade Runner movie. I built 25 cars for that movie. Wow. Back to the Future, I built the police car and one of the DeLoreans they lifted to fly, made the wheels fold under. So
you did that?
Yes.
Wow, Gene, that is fantastic.
And I have a book out now on movie cars, television, and commercials.
That is brilliant.
Did all kinds of commercials.
You even built the space shuttle for the Enterprise on Star Trek, didn't
Star
you?
Trek. I designed it, and then I had an artist do a rendering. I took the rendering to Matt Jeffries, the art director. He says, that's fine, let's go, let's do it. So he okayed it, and I went home and started building.
What a fascinating insight into your history, your design, everything you've done. Is there anything you can teach me?
Oh, yeah.
I feel like I'm in there.
Come on in here, we'd work on some metal.
I'm standing on the shoulder of a giant, and I want to learn something. This looks good, Gene.
Well, Mike, I got a few things together ahead of time because I know you wanted to see some of this, you know?
I did, yeah.
When you hammer weld, when you weld two pieces of metal together, see, like this, this is two pieces, we're gonna weld it here. All the weld, all kinds of weld, pulls towards the weld when it cools down.
Gotcha.
All weld.
Yeah.
So the pulling towards the weld makes the warpage. It warps the panel.
Yeah.
So when I hammer weld, I hammer it so hard and so violently that it overcomes the pull. So the metal pulls back and becomes one.
One again.
Becomes one. And then after I weld it and it becomes one, I can stretch it and roll it and do anything I want.
So this is a piece that's already been welded down the middle.
Yes, I hammer welded this piece. See, you can see the weld on this side.
Yeah, I can see it. Let's have a little holder. So now you've got these two pieces of metal welded together.
Yes.
You can roll this, you can bend it, you can change it. It's never going to split.
Right. If it's hammer welded, you can stretch it and form it.
Right, let's go for it then.
The most common thing that people do when they're gas welding, when they're learning how to gas weld, is they have too much oxygen for the amount of acetylene, and it gives you a bad weld.
Right.
But they don't know that, see? But the way you govern that is you put a little tail on it like that, and then you bring the tail down till it's barely sharp. And that gives you a perfect mixture.
Wonderful.
See?
Again, another little lesson.
Yes. Every day is a school day.
Yeah, but it is a school day. This is a painstaking way of mating two pieces of metal. But when you make show cars, you have to expect that every square inch is going to be scrutinised. All the more so when it's a Gene Winfield show car. How important is it for you to be teaching these skills to the next generation? Because
it's very important because I want to have people continue it on. So I give classes all over the world. And when I do a class, I have young and old.
Yeah.
I have old body men that's been doing body work for 30, 40 years. And then I have young kids that, you know, only 17, 18 years old, and they're just now learning. So I don't mind, and I like to teach everybody, and I like to continue this, the art of metal shaping.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, now I'm gonna heat it up. All right, there we go.